वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू. आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू द आई कैन इनिशिएटिव द हिंदू एंड इंडियन एक्सप्रेस एनालिसिस. सो वी विल स्टार्ट द डे विद द स्टोरी ऑफ द डे. दिस इज अ स्टोरी ऑफ एन इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट एंड अ फिशरमैन. सो वंस एन इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट एंड फिशरमैन, दे आर सिटिंग बाय द साइड ऑफ अ सी एंड द इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट नोटिसेस दैट दिस फिशरमैन इंस्टेड ऑफ फिशिंग इज जस्ट चिलिंग देयर ऑन द कोस्ट बिसाइड हिज बोट. सो सरप्राइज्ड द इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट आस्क्स द फिशरमैन दैट व्हाई आर यू नॉट फिशिंग. So fisherman says that because I have caught enough fish for the day, so I want to chill now. Then industrialist says, then if you have time left, why are you not catching more fish? The fisherman asks, then what would I do with that? Then the industrialist explains him that if you catch more fish, you will earn more money, and if you have more money, you will buy a motorized boat. If you have a motorized boat, you will go to deep waters, and if you go to deep waters, you will catch more fish. With more fish, you will get more money, and with more money, you may buy two more boats, and tomorrow you may be the owner of a fleet of boats, and you will be a rich person like me. So the fisherman asks, then what would I do after that? What would I do after I become a rich person like you? Then the industrialist says that then you can sit back and enjoy life like I'm doing now. The fisherman says, what do you think I'm doing now? So fisherman is also chilling, and the businessman is also chilling. So at the end, both of them are chilling. But what this whole story shows is that in life, we need to have contentment. So contentment is very important factor in life. The other day we had discussed an essay that the gratitude is the simplest form of joy. So that is very true. We need to have gratitude for whatever we have, and we need to have some contentment in life. So satisfied life is a happy life. So that's when we learn to enjoy life and be in the present. This story also highlights that the way human beings are now want more and more of everything. That is, human beings have become more greedy. And this is affecting the whole society. It is affecting the environment and even the animals. So this can be used in philosophical essays the quote of Gandhiji, which says the earth is enough for everyone's need, but not for anyone's greed. So this story also shows that we need to be watchful of our own actions and emotions. So what we want in life, but what we are doing in life. So that self-introspection, that self-analysis and self-observation is also very important. So we will start with the topics of the day now. We will start with the first topic of the day, which is an example of community policing. So community policing as an idea, it was based on the premise that the law abiders can become law enforcers. So police cannot be everywhere, and police cannot be omnipresent to check the occurrence of crime. So where, in which area, which street the criminals are hiding, who are keeping weapons, who are undertaking illegal activities, all of these things, it is very difficult for the police themselves to be able to keep a tab. So the basic premise was that if people from the community are themselves involved with the police, if they are also connected to the police, then they can act as informants to the police regarding any criminal activities which are occurring in the society. Then the police can take immediate action. So it was felt that the civilians are police without uniform in the society, who can support and help the police in keeping and ensuring law and order in the society. So one such example of community policing that started in Tamil Nadu was the Friends of Police movement. So in the Friends of movement, this was started sometime 25 years before. This was started by the then superintendent of police in Ramanathapuram district, Mr. Prateep V. Philip. So then more and more people from the society, they started joining this Friends of movement, Friends of People movement. So it became so widely popular that it was recognized as a movement. So here the people were attached to the police stations across Tamil Nadu. And even Prateep V. Philip went on to win Queen's Award for Innovation in Police Training and for his contribution to community policing. But the flip side of this example of community policing has been that in the past, there have been several allegations that the members of the Friends of Police, that is the volunteers, they have been having some high-handed behavior, and they are approaching the people or talking to them with more their behavior is more oppressive, and more brutal treatment is being committed by them. So this has been the allegations. So now that the recent episode of the custodial deaths in Tamil Nadu has happened, there have been reports that these volunteers from the Friends of People movement have also been involved in this. So it was at this juncture that the state government has decided to withdraw this order that it had issued way back in 1994, where it had extended the Friends of Police movement to the whole state of Tamil Nadu. So now the state government is withdrawing this order, because apparently the FOP volunteers were involved in this custodial death case. So reports of their involvement are have seen that their FOP volunteers are involved. So on the one hand, it shows an example of community policing, the Friends of People movement. But on the other side, it also shows the flip side of such movements, where the people, when they are involved in enforcing the laws, they may also show some high-handed behavior. So you may have a question like, what is community policing, and analyze its role in enforcing law and order. So in that case, and it can use this as an example to show the flip side of the community policing. Now we'll move on to the next topic, which is social contract. So this whole editorial, it basically connects the social contract with the present day, the modern day governments. Social contract, those people who have read some ethics portions or public administration and PSIR would know what social contract is. So social contract as a theory was put forward by thinkers like Hobbes and Rorschach, where they felt that Hobbes, for instance, felt that man is inherently bad. So he is nasty and he is also brutish. So Rorschach felt that man is born free. However, they both agreed upon the point that there is the social contract that happens in the society, which means that several people in the society, they feel that individually when they are exercising their rights, but sometimes exercise of one's rights comes in conflict with the exercise of the right by another person. So this leads to more conflicts and problems in the society. There may be fights, there may be violence and disturbance. So in order to reduce all this, the people came together and come together and they decide on two things. One is that they are going to give up a part of their individual rights so that collectively they can lead a life which is harmonious. So individually they are going to give up some rights so that collectively they can live in harmony. And the second decision that the people take is that in order to enforce this social contract, which people have come together and formulated, they will have one person or some people out of these number of people, they will be given that power and authority to enforce this social contract. So these were the two things that the people agreed as part of social contract. Now, what is happening in the modern day governments and how they are seeing social contract? The modern day governments, they too have a social contract with the people, because the people have voted and made them win, and the governments in power are nothing but the representative of the people. So they enjoy the sovereign power with the consent of the people only. It is the people who have brought them to power by voting for them. So in a way, the modern day governments and the people also have a social contract between them. But how is this social contract now being taken up? Governments have been aggrandizing more power. They have been concentrating more power in their hands under the garb of public good. So that is, they say that governments know what is in the best interest of people. So they know what people, what is best for people, and they also feel that for public good, some of the individual rights may have to be compromised for the good of all. So this way, the rights of the people are being taken, and under the garb of public good, the governments are concentrating more power. So in this way, there is this bend from individual will to a collective will. So the collective good is sought after, and under the garb of public good, concentration of power in the hands of the governments has increased. So in this case, What has happened is when the governments have the social contract with the people, the governments always, more often than not, hear the voice of the majority. So the voiceless, they go unnoticed and their grievances become unheard. So therefore, there is always this difference between the voiced versus the voiceless. So where the government observes its social contract with the voiced set of people, but the social contract with the voiceless gets breached because their grievances are hardly heard. So in India, in the whole thing is now being connected to the pandemic. In the case of pandemic, if you see that there are two Indias. The first is an India which is privileged enough to observe social distancing, order groceries online, and largely it obeys the government directives and takes all the precautions. But there is a second India which crowds the railway terminals, travels long distances, even hundreds of kilometers walking. So the second set of people, the migrants, are mostly the voiceless and their grievances are unheard. While the first set of people, the voiced, are the privileged ones with whom the government observes the social contract. So it is said that in this pandemic, everybody is together, but that is hardly the case. The brunt of the pandemic has fallen mostly on this set of voiceless people. In this backdrop, HLA Hart has commented that freedom can be valueless to those too poor to make use of it. So what will you do by giving freedom to a person who is too poor to even make use of it? So therefore, what is more important is for this voiceless people to be converted to the voiced people. They need to be empowered by giving space to them, by giving voice to them. Their issues need to be heard. So regard, what is the way forward? The way forward is that now under this social contract, the governments have been concentrating more power under the garb of social, under the garb of public will. So this has to give way to more decentralization. So there has to be more decentralization of power, and we need to reduce this concentration of power in the hands of the state. And also there needs to be more sensitive and also responsive administration, so that the issues of these people who are the voiceless also gets heard. And Hobbes, he talks about the mighty state as a Leviathan. Leviathan means which could rule by the will of the majority. But if the will of the majority, if we go by, then these voiceless people will never be heard. So therefore, in this case, the need is for more decentralization and sensitive and responsive administration. So what we need at the end of the day is we need to rewrite the social contract again. So while rewriting the social contract, we need to fundamentally introspect and think about what should be the role of the governing class, what should be the role of the bureaucrats. So this rewriting of the social contract is the basic thing that is required now. So in this context, you can also talk about Gandhiji's talisman, where he says that what becomes important is for us to think about that poor person, that last man, and for him to be happy is important. So with this, we move to the next topic. This whole editorial, it began with a very good introduction which can be used in the essays. So the whole editorial begins with the novel and what the novel deals with, and then it is beautifully connected to the current status in India. So the novel this editorial begins with is a blindness. The name of the novel is Blindness, and that is written by a Portuguese Nobel laureate, José Saramago. So this novel is about a mysterious epidemic that suddenly starts spreading among the people. So there is this city where people suddenly start turning blind. So a person is with his car on a traffic signal and he suddenly goes blind. So he requests another man to drop him to the house, to his home. The man drops this blind man to the home, but again runs away with his car. Then this contact, when it starts spreading and starts slowly affecting all the people in the city. Then those of the people who have become blind, they are taken to a quarantine in an asylum. And also this novel doesn't describe people by their names. So the person who turned blind in a car at a traffic signal, so he has not been given any name. People have only descriptions, like the doctor, the doctor's wife, the girl with the dark glass, like that. There are only descriptions of people. So what these people experience at the quarantine is that they don't have access to good food. The condition there is very unhygienic. There is brutality. There is apathy over these people. So these people at the quarantine facility are at the brink of starvation. So they all decide and somehow escape the asylum and they enter the city. And what they see in the city is that everybody in the city has already turned blind. So they do not have any support and the country, entire country plunges into this despair. But suddenly there is a magical resurrection happens and the entire city then again becomes as usual normal. So after the description of this whole novel ends, this whole description is very beautifully connected with the current state in India. It says that this novel or this story has a very similar or very obvious connections with the pandemic in India. So in this, it says that the novel is named Blindness, and there is blindness with respect to pandemic in India also. So there is blindness regarding the number of migrant workers in India. So we do not even have authentic data regarding the number of migrant workers. The chief labor commissioner states that there are nearly 26 lakh migrant workers. But the economic survey data says that there are nearly 8 crore migrant workers. So we do not even know what is the exact number of migrant workers which are there in India. Secondly, there is also anonymity. Just like in the novel, people are not given names, but they are only described by some of the characteristics. Even in this case, there is anonymity because these migrants, who are they, what are their issues, is hardly recognized. Like we spoke about in the previous editorial, these are the set of voiceless people. Because of all this, there is also a lack of anonymity. There is lack of accountability on the part of the government. So many people start exploiting the migrant workers. So therefore, the whole novel is connected to the blindness aspect with respect to migrant workers and also anonymity of the migrant workers in as far as governance is concerned. The next blindness that we see in India is with respect to hunger. So the first blindness was with respect to migrant workers, and next is with respect to hunger. So under this, it says that there is NFSA Act which is supposed to be giving free food grains until November now. So this has been the recent move. But however, this free food grains is going to be provided to only those people who have ration card. So in this actually creates two problems. One is that many prominent economists like Jean Rees and Ritika Khera, they have said that roughly 10 crore eligible beneficiaries, even today, they continue to be excluded from NFSA. So why is there such exclusion? Because government is still relying on the 2011 census. So after that, there has been growth of population, and now there are more people who actually need such food grain assistance. But because we still rely on 2011 census, there is an under coverage when it comes to NFSA. So all nearly 10 crore people are now already excluded. And also many of these migrants and self-employed workers, they don't even have ration cards. All of these people will be excluded. So now imagine if you have an essay on the migrants issue, which you may in all probability have given the magnitude of importance this issue has assumed, then you can begin your essay with this novel, and then how seamlessly it is getting connected to the issue of pandemic in India. So this is how you have to very innovatively begin your essay to capture the attention of the evaluator. Now with this, we will go to the next. It is related to environmental issues. So the editorial begins by saying that in the recent times, because of the COVID and the lockdown, there is a feeling in the country that we need to take a lot of steps for the economic revival. So because of such a feeling, there is a tendency to give a very quick approval to various projects which might end up violating various environmental norms. So the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change has in the recent past considered and even cleared multiple such projects which may be present in the critical wildlife habitats. So for example, there is the Italian hydropower project, which is there in the biodiversity rich Dibang Valley in Arunachal Pradesh. Similarly, a coal mine project is there in Assam's Dehingpatkai Elephant Reserve. And then diamond mining has been now proposed in Panna Forested Belt. So similarly, a coal mine is to be operated by the Adani Enterprises in the forest belt of Odisha. So therefore, there has been approval and even clearance of projects which are being proposed in these critical habitat, critical wildlife habitats. And the ministry has even considered and given approval to several of these projects. So this is one. Second is the way these approvals have been given. Now, because of the restrictions on meeting and the norms of social distancing, these projects have been considered via video conferencing. So where it is not even possible to examine all the necessary documents and also the real impact what this project is going to have on the environment is possible to be assessed when there are site inspections. But virtually the site is also not inspected. All the necessary documents are not properly seen. In fact, on several proposals, just 10 minutes is spent on video conferencing and it is getting the green signal. So the way the clearance is given is again the second issue that is problematic. And third is a draft environmental impact assessment notification about which we have already discussed. So some of the troubling points in this include, the first is that even if a project is started without an EIA being done, it can be done post facto. So even if a project is started without the EIA being done, it won't be considered as a violation and the project can still be regularized post facto. That is one thing. So post facto EIA is also now can be done. The second is a large number of projects are exempted from public hearing by putting them under a subjective category of strategic. So all those projects which are considered strategic will be exempted from public hearings. But public hearings are very important because they are the only means through which the project affected people and their concerns can be heard. So but now this is again being done away with. Also, even if the environmental impact assessment is done and a report is made, so the report will say what mitigation measures the project proponent will have to undertake to minimize the impact on the environment. But this draft EIA notification talks nothing about the monitoring and compliance by the project proponent. So this again is missing. These are various issues when it comes to the draft EIA. So what is going to be the result of such an approach by us? The first thing is it is going to lead to further environmental degradation. So building such infrastructure mining projects within critical wildlife habitats is going to endanger these habitats. So endangering these habitats is going to increase our vulnerability to various infectious diseases and is going to bring us in direct contact with various viruses as well. So with this related is the socio-economic shocks that we are going to suffer because of such increased vulnerability. And when we are suffering socio-economic shocks, it is very difficult to achieve self-reliance or Atmanirbharta that has become our prime aim now. So endangering such habitats is going to finally affect our aim for self-reliance or Atmanirbharta itself. And this is precisely why we should avoid such measures where we are disturbing the critical wildlife habitats for the sake of economic development. Rather, what we need is more sustainable development. Now we go to the next topic, which is an analysis regarding the standing committees. So you may have a question in the polity paper, that is what are departmentally related standing committees and analyze their working. So in that case, piece of news, it speaks about the standing committee on in the Rajya Sabha and what has been the stand of Rajya Sabha Secretariat. So one example given is that Standing Committee on Science and Technology, which is headed by Jairam Ramesh, had recommended that for these standing committees to have quorum, so there must be 11 members out of the 30 members. But because it is not possible for various 11 members who may belong to different states to be gathering at the same place for the meeting to be conducted, Jairam Ramesh advised that there must be virtual meetings so that quorum can be ensured, so that more people can join. But Rajya Sabha Secretariat has denied this and it has said that quorum is essential only when the committees are taking some decisions or they are adopting some reports, but quorum is not essential when there is routine deliberations happening. So if you see few examples, there is the Standing Committee on Science and Technology and Environment and Forest. In the last 3 years, this committee has held 32 meetings. But out of these, in 22% of the meetings, there was no quorum. Similarly, the Committee on Home Affairs, it has held 38 meetings in which 21% of the meetings, there was no quorum. So without quorum, effective deliberations cannot happen and the contribution of these standing committees will therefore be diluted. So this is one of the important flaws in the functioning of the standing committees, which you can quote in your answer. Next is social media and hate speech. So in this, we know that hate speech has, the instances of hate speech has been on an increase, and given the spread of social media and also the lack of proper regulation on social media, this hate speech on social media can spread like a wildfire. So in this backdrop, Facebook has allowed several controversial posts by United States President Donald Trump to be posted on the social media. So as Facebook has not taken any steps to deal with these controversial posts, several advertisers have now have boycotted the social media, that is Facebook. So why? Because many of these posts on social media, that is on Facebook, they target the minorities, or they are those kind of statements which is promoting more discrimination in the society. So therefore, these social media platforms need to take responsibility for this and they need to take steps to tackle this. But as Facebook was not taking any steps, several advertisers, in fact more than 900 advertisers, which includes major brands like Coca-Cola and Unilever, they had come together and they had boycotted Facebook because it was not taking any measures to boycott the controversial posts by Donald Trump or other hate speech statements which have been put up on the social media. So hate speech and the evils of social media are definitely a very important topic. So this can be used as an example that these advertisers have boycotted Facebook and therefore they are pressurizing Facebook to take steps against hate speech. So now we go to the next topic, which is related to India-China relations. Again, we have seen a lot in this. And this was an interview with the former Indian ambassador to China, Gautam Bambawale. So just the few important things that he tells, I'll be discussing. So what he says is, even though India and China both are ancient civilizations, there is a difference between their values. What India, the India's value system talks about Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. What it means is India sees the entire world as one family, but China's what in Chinese, China is referred to as Chungwu. Chungwu means it is a middle kingdom or a middle country. That means China sees that China is at the middle of the world, that is, it is at the center of the world, and every other country, every people, they revolve around China. So China feels it is the sun in a solar system. So therefore, there is a fundamental difference in our value systems, and therefore it is two different people who are adopting two different approaches. Next is, we'll be talking about two reasons which the former ambassador Gautam Bambawale says that are responsible for the current behavior of China. One reason is tactical and the other is strategic. The tactical reason is very simple, that China wants to try and move its ground positions. And it wants to move its troops till the point where China feels is the LAC. Because India and China, even though we have had several agreements in the past, but there is no clear agreement as to where this LAC actually is. So both India and China have different opinions and different perceptions about where the LAC actually is. So what China wants to do is that now China thinks that it is so powerful that it can unilaterally now define LAC according to its own perceptions and bring troops up to its own perception of LAC and then present India with a fait accompli. So this is the tactical reason for China that it is moving the troops on the ground. It is changing the ground positions because there is no clear-cut understanding or perception about the LAC. The second reason is the strategic reason. Strategic reason is based on the fact that there is a power differential between the two countries, between India and China. So China is trying to bully us. It is trying to show that China is the superpower in Asia, and we have to agree to this point that China is the superpower in Asia. So therefore, China is trying to bully us and show that we are an inferior power compared to China. So these are the two important or different categories of reason, tactical and strategic, when we analyze why China is behaving like this at the border. So this, you can use such categorization along with mentioning the name of the former ambassador Gautam Bambawale. So that will add more value to the answer.
And it is trying to exert the next part of the same article fact is that there is a power differential between other countries to being China and she is in further China now.
The last difference
first is
the economic
muscular
approach with
which
when
China
we compare
is
the GDP of India and China.
So
they
there are
very
multiple
similar
examples
but
which
now
shows
the GDP of China approach of China 4.5 times the way it is behaving aggressively in the South China.
So this shows the growing
economic
clout of China in
the
region.
Second
is
the power differential
which we
already
discussed.
This concept of
now
that there
China
is this power differential
and national
we had
security
in one article
that was
written
by
C. Rajamohan.
Then
so
even
China
is completely aware that it is
and China
powerful,
has much more powerful
trade
than
war
with
the
United States,
States
also.
Region.
And China is now
so, and it is trying
to
heating up
the
India-China
border as
well.
This
so
fact that
talk
there
about
is a power differential
in the region
wants other
countries
to be
United States
it.
For that matter. China
and
is adopting an
aggressive
war.
Last
difference
is the
aggressive
or the
muscular
approach
changed
to
China.
China
is approaching
to
China.
Of the
so there
are
multiple
examples
which
totally
shows
the
muscular
approach of China. One is the way it is behaving aggressively in the South China Sea. Second is the Hong Kong. In Hong Kong also there is one country, two systems formula, but however now China has imposed a national security law which is applicable to Hong Kong also. Then even China is threatening Taiwan, and China has a trade war with the United States also, and China is now heating up the India-China border as well. So talk about any country in the region, even United States for that matter, China is adopting an aggressive or a muscular approach. So this is the change to China today that we see compared to the China of the which was nearly 2-3 decades before. So now we see another aspect of India-China relation, which is the trade relations. So in the 1950s, India and China entered into trade agreement. So what this whole article talks about is that this trade agreement that was entered into was itself a biased trade agreement. So this trade agreement was never based on the equality of power of the two countries. This trade agreement was itself very biased. It was one-sided agreement. So for this, we have to look at the China's exports. So under this trade agreement, China was allowed to export cereals, machinery, minerals, silk and silk products, paper, stationery. So these were the several items that China was exporting, and India's exports comprised of mainly raw materials, unmanufactured ores, wood and timber. So if you look at the kind of the nature of exports of India and China, it is very clear that China was exporting, India was exporting mainly the primary produce of India, and China was exporting more broad-based items and manufactured items. So India was exporting just the raw materials, China was adding value to it, making manufactured goods out of it and exporting the same again to India. So therefore, the trade agreement was itself biased. So if you look at, these were just the broad headings, but if you look at the subcategories, and if you take, for instance, the paper and stationery. So under that, the China's exports involved packing paper, newsprint, fountain pens, pencils, ink printing ink, and all these. And it is in these areas that precisely India also had a domestic advantage. India also had a domestic base for producing all of these items. But still, India had agreed in the agreement that China will export these items to India. But India's export of the same items to China was not there in the agreement. So therefore, the agreement that was entered way back in the 1950s itself was a biased one, where we did not take an advantage of the comparative advantage that we had. So this agreement, this 1954 agreement, it is said that by any yardstick, it was one-sided agreement. So India did not negotiate properly, and therefore it became a one-sided agreement. We gave away too much but received too less in return. So this is about the trade agreement between India and China. Now we move on to the next topic, which is digitizing the state. So this editorial says that India as a state, India as a country, has been growing since the time of independence. At the time of independence in 1947, we had a union budget which was just 197 crore big. But now we have a union budget in which the budget is for 30 lakh crore. So this shows the amount of growth that has happened in the government. Similarly, the total government expenditure could be higher than 70 lakh crore also. So the size of the Indian budget has increased from 197 crore to 30 lakh crore. So that is a huge increase in the government. But however, our transactions, they were earlier manual in nature, where there was manual transactions that were happening, payments were made manually, and data entry was also made manually. But now what has happened is we have transformed from manual entry of data to a computerized form of data. But what actually during this manual way of operations, it led to very unreliable and incoherent data. So as everything was done manually, there was no coherency and the data became extremely unreliable. In order to ensure that there is more transparency and good governance, we started a drive for computerization in the government. So what we need actually is comprehensive data, a reliable data, a secure and accessible data, and a data set which is also searchable based on our needs. This is what is required by us. So however, what we did during this process of computerization is, whatever processes were manual before, they were just made mechanized. So we just converted these manual processes into the mechanized forms. But there was no change in the processes themselves. That is, we did not go for a business process re-engineering, but rather only the manual processes were just made to be on computer. It was just mechanized. So what this led to is different departments had their own separate set of databases, and there was no organic links between these databases, of which there were four main problems that we started to encounter. First is the incomparable data. For example, the salary expenditure across different states could not be compared because they were separate databases and there was no integration between them. Next is the data was obscure. Why it was obscure? Because a large amount of the expenditure was put under the head called as other or miscellaneous, where it was difficult to determine on what exactly was this spent. So data also became very obscure. Third is it became non-traceable. Why non-traceable? Because it was very difficult to determine the actual expenditure. Reason being that we started to incur a lot of expenditure through giving some temporary advances. A lot of money was drawn under as temporary advances, and at the end of it was difficult to determine what the actual expenditure was, when and how much was incurred. So the expenditure itself became more non-traceable because a lot of amounts were going out as just temporary grants or temporary advances. Next is a misclassification. So data was also being misclassified. For example, grants in aid that were given to the state, they were misclassified as capital expenditure, which should have been rather revenue expenditure. So these and also some of the amounts were booked under what is called a suspense head. So all these led to misclassification of data. These were the four important problems that we started to face because we just converted the manual processes to the mechanized form without any process re-engineering itself. In order to tackle all this, we started with DATA, which is Digital Accountability and Transparency Act, which has been proposed. So the challenge for this act would be to the government computerization has only led to mechanization of manual processes without business process re-engineering. So the challenge for Data Act, the data would now be to actually go for the process re-engineering rather than just mechanizing the manual processes. So for this, we need to do these five things. One is we have to establish common digital standards. So digital standards need to be common across the departments between the center and states so that the data can be more coherent, it can be more reliable and comprehensive. The second thing is we need to go for end-to-end computerized data capture. So every single amount of data needs to be computerized. There has to be end-to-end computerization right from the sanction of the funds till the time of its dispersal. Every step needs to be computerized. So only then, if the data capture happens from end to end, only then it will have some meaning and there will be completeness and reliable data. The next is we need to go for integration of data. So there are several databases and we need to integrate them. So this is very important also because to make the data more interoperable, and also there will be a lot of redundancy in the data which needs to be removed. So for all this, the integration becomes very important. The next step we need to do is cognitive intelligence. Once we have the integrated databases where we have ensured interoperability and we have also removed any redundancy, then we can go for analytical tools. So like artificial intelligence, machine learning, etc., which can give us data on which we can take some actions. That is, it can provide us actionable inputs for policy making. And the last thing we have to ensure is the privacy of the data, and also the security of the data needs to be ensured. So while we are talking about converting or computerization, which involves process re-engineering, these are the five things which we need to include as a part of the framework. So now we go to the next topic, which is NIRF rankings. Even in the past, we have seen articles about the limitations in the NIRF rankings. So even in this article, we will see another limitation of the NIRF rankings. So when we look at the parameters that are involved in the NIRF rankings, which is done by the Ministry of Human Resource Development to rank the higher educational institutions in India, there are various parameters which are considered. One is the teacher to student ratio. Next is the financial resource utilization, how efficiently and optimally the financial resources are utilized, and what is the level of outreach and diversity of students in these higher educational institutions, and what is the perception about these institutions in the eyes of public and the stakeholders. So there are various such parameters, but what this whole editorial argues is that these parameters, they do not actually hold any ground, because the institutions we are ranking are the those which are funded by the government, and those government funded institutions have very limited flexibility when we talk about all these things. So now in the NIRF rankings, there are few top colleges that top every year. So for example, the Lady Shri Ram College, then the Miranda House. So these are the colleges, Hindu College, these are the colleges which are in the top rankings every year. And the first thing is regarding the perception itself. So there is already a perception that these colleges are extremely good and therefore they always rank best in the perception. And the second we come to is a teacher-student ratio. As far as teacher-student ratio is concerned, it is not really something that is there in the hands of these colleges. These colleges are government funded and the number of teachers, everything is more or less fixed, and they do not have any flexibility regarding this. So, and also when the students are to be admitted, because these colleges are government funded, they will have to admit all those who make past a declared cutoff marks. So all those who are getting more than the cutoff marks will have to be admitted. There is no flexibility in this regard also. The same goes true with the diversity quotient of the college also. So there is no flexibility left for these colleges to admit students from diverse socioeconomic backgrounds. So there is hardly anything that the college has a role to play in this. So next is if you talk about the resources use, the financial resource utilization. Here again, in terms of resource use also, the resources are allocated and this allocation is also very rigid. Even if a slight deviation is made in this allocation, it will attract penal action. When we talk of teachers' appointments and promotions, they are also controlled by the respective affiliating universities. So the point I'm trying to make here is that there is an existing regulatory framework which has been very rigid, and therefore it gives these colleges very less flexibility to make their own innovation in terms of pedagogy. So when such policies of the government, the policy directions are so strict, and the colleges do not have much flexibility to make a difference in these parameters, then there is no point in ranking the colleges and institutions based on these parameters. So any other college could have equally performed well on these parameters. It is just that it starts from this perception which these colleges already have, and in this perception parameter they rank very high. So it is not to say that these colleges which are top ranked every year, they lack the potential to do so, but it is just that they already have a good perception in the eyes of the public. So only the creamy layer, that is the best of the best in the academics, only get into these colleges, and that is the reason why they are also able to produce good results. But for a real assessment to happen, what we need to do is we need to remove these structural rigidities which are associated with these colleges and bring all the colleges at par with each other so that a level playing field is provided, and then assess the performance of these colleges. So this is the inherent flaw in the NIRF ranking. Now these were the other editorials which were not relevant from the exam point of view. Now we'll discuss yesterday's question. So the question was to analyze the performance of the midday meal scheme. So in that, in the introduction, you can say about any recent reports by the CAG. CAG had done a performance audit on MDMS, so which talks about the impact this scheme has had. Or you can simply start by giving a brief introduction of the midday meal scheme. So it is started by Ministry of Human Resource Development, and it is a centrally sponsored scheme which was started in the year 95, and it was started with a twofold aim. One is to improve the nutritional income of the students, and the other is to ensure that there is retention of the students in the school. So in order to reduce the dropout of children in the school and ensure higher retention and to improve the nutritional outcomes, these were the twin aims of MDMS. So by saying the ministry and what kind of scheme it is and what is the aim of the scheme, this can be a very simple and good introduction to start the answer. And then you can start with the analysis part of the MDMS scheme. So under this scheme, there are also the MDMS rules of 2015 which were provided, and many of these rules are not upheld, or they are not even followed. For example, the guidelines says that the children will have to be given food which has X number of calories and Y amount of proteins. This is also not followed properly. So this is also not followed. Second is that there are these school management committees which come under the RTE Act. So these school management committees are actually to monitor the implementation of the midday meal scheme. But in many cases, these school management committees are not active, and they don't actively monitor the implementation of the projects. And then next is whenever due to non-availability of food grains, it is not possible to serve meal to the children, then the state government will have to provide a food security allowance if for 15 days the cooked meals are not provided. But such allowances are also not provided to children. The next thing is that these across the states, what kind of meal is provided differs a lot. So some states are offering even eggs and milk, while some states are not offering. So therefore, there is a limitation when it comes to the basket of food which are offered as part of the midday meal scheme. So eggs are considered to be not vegetarian, and they are not provided in the schools, though it is a rich source of nutrition. Next is that again, the menu is not diversified. It is mainly just the dal and the rotis. So there is a suggestion that we need to increase the giving of more millets and micronutrients, because micronutrient deficiency is also very predominant. So that was also not done. Next is related to the hygiene issue. So there have been many cases in the past where the children have suffered from food poisoning because of unhygienic food being served at the midday meal scheme. There have been instances where children have also been hospitalized and some of them have even died. So one such incident happened in August 2018 in Jharkhand, where more than 60 children were hospitalized after they had their midday meal scheme. In 2018, again in Delhi, 30 students suffered food poisoning. And so there are many such incidences where because of food poisoning, children have suffered, which shows the unhygienic conditions in which the food is prepared. The next is, it is said that for this midday meal scheme, it is increasing the responsibility on part of the teachers. So the teachers will have to report upon the giving of the midday meal schemes. They will have to take account of how it is being done. So this is imposing an additional burden on the teachers and reducing their time to attend to the children. So this issue is also there. Then these meals are prepared by the cooks and the helpers who are given honorariums. So the honorarium amount that is given to these midday meal cooks, they are very less, and the payment is also very irregular. So this is a big disincentive for them to prepare hygienic and healthy food. That is one more thing. And then also that there are caste barriers, because there have been instances where the cooks, the midday meal cooks, have been from the scheduled castes, and the parents of the children have did not want their children to eat the food cooked by a cook who belongs to the so-called lower caste. So these kind of caste biasness and discrimination is also seen in the implementation of the midday meal schemes. So you can write some 8 to 10 such negatives, and then you can also analyze the positives, that it has improved the nutritional outcome of the children and it has also helped in improving the retention of children. You can quote the data of the increase in the enrollment in the primary schools for children, and this can also be linked to in part to the midday meal schemes, and also particularly in the tribal endemic regions where there was a lot of malnutrition that was prevalent. With the start of the midday meal scheme, this chronic malnutrition has also reduced. So these examples you can quote, and you can conclude with a way forward. So in the way forward, again you can write that first of all, we need to increase the fund allocation to the scheme. So there has been a fall in the fund allocation which needs to be corrected. Second, we need to go for social audit of a more frequent and better coverage through the social audits, so that it is linked to the outcomes that it is generating, and also there are corruption and such issues are not there. Then the school management committees need to be further empowered so that there is constant monitoring, and to ensure that safe and hygienic food is given to the children. We need to diversify the lunch menu so that the millets, eggs and milk, etc. are included, so that the micronutrient deficiency that is prevalent among the children is also can also be elevated. Then we need to improve the condition of the cooks and the helpers by improving their honorarium, and so that it acts as an incentive for them to work well. So with all these things, and one more thing is that these cooking contracts can be given to various self-help groups which are performing really well. So this will provide employment to the women of these self-help groups, and also the children can get healthy and hygienic cooked food. So roping in of various self-help groups is also very important to better implementation of the MDMS. Through all this way forward, you can conclude answer. So today's question is, discuss the importance of community policing in India. It is a 10 marker question for 150 words. So that's it for today. Thank you.